accepted, and which will see evidence of this. Again, look at Albert Pike here, who's a 33-degree Freemason, and this will help us understand how he thinks. He's got a book here called Morals and Dogma, which you can, any Freemason can go into a lodge and look in the library and actually read this book. And he says here, that which we must say to a crowd, which is the public, we worship a God, but it is the God that one adores without superstition. So the lower masses will kind of think that, oh, this is maybe some curious Christian, you know. But he says, to you, Solomon Grand Inspectors General, we say this, that you may repeat it to the brethren of the 32nd, 31st, and 30th degrees, so these are the very high level degrees, the Masonic religion should be, by all of us initiates of the high degrees, maintained in the purity of the Luciferian doctrine. If Lucifer were not God, then Adonai, God of Christianity, whose deeds prove his cruelty, perfidy, and hatred of man, so again they're thinking that our God is bad and that Lucifer is good. So, but at the same time, we're actually learning some evidence here of the way they think. Is that the high Freemasons are telling the public that they worship a God, but they don't actually say who it is. And the great architecture of the universe can really be any God. You know, that's what we'll be finding out here. And we'll be reading more of this later on here. What we're going to look at is the all-seeing eye of Freemasonry. This will also help us understand. Now, you'll notice there's a sun here. And then you've got an eye, a shining eye. And just so you understand that in Bethlehem, which was a cult that Constantine was part of, so the secret society, just like Freemasonry is that it would have two suns. You'd have the invisible sun, which would likely be Sirius, the star Sirius, and then you'd have the physical sun. So this is more like high-level interpretation, and then to have the visible sun in the sky, and then when you look at the two suns were meant to meet with each other and shake hands. And I find it interesting in Mithraism is that they have a Latin word that which means those united by the handshake. And I find it interesting that the Freemasons have secret handshakes that they normally use. So I find that some of the archaeology of Mithraism is that you see them doing strange, blindfolded, like almost like a death and resurrection kind of rituals. And you find certain similarities in some of the rituals of Freemasonry as well. So this could explain why you would have two suns, one for the eye, all shining eye, and then of course the moon. I don't know if the moon is on the Masonic point. You could get about that, so I don't know. Not sure about that. What we're going to do is we're going to look at the Deception of Constantine documentary. We're going to look at how Apollo is merged with the Catholic Jesus as a sun god by Constantine. We're just going to look further into this, and of course when we look at the source here, we understand that Apollo was a Greek and a Roman god as well. Apollo is also another form of Egyptian goddess. Helios identified at times with Apollo, because Helios was the sun god as well, he went through the chariot, and he was also known as the all-seeing eye. So find that interesting, that's what you'll find when you're looking at this. And when we look at the riddles in stone, the secret architecture of Washington, D.C., this is a documentary I found. It says in the ancient times of the Egyptians, they would tell everyone the sun is God, and this is actually low-level interpretation. The priests believed that it was not the sun that was God, but the spirit that flows through the physical sun. But then there's this another level of interpretation, and it is the star Sirius, the dog star, that is the supreme god. And it was the most evil star in the Egyptian pantheon. And of course we understand Apollo, or Helios, it's almost like there's another interpretation that he's being elevated to the invisible sun, as well as shining eye, Sirius. And so this could actually explain why the Freemasonry, why they would have two suns, just like the Mithraism, the Sirius, they would have two suns, one that's invisible, and the one that can be physically seen in the sky. And when we look at the Freemasons Hall at the United Grand Lodge of England, just remember that Helios is also another form of Apollyon, so we need to think of Apollyon as well, the destroying angel. Is that you find here, and this is down in England, that the Corinthian colors that represent beauty, and then we have have the old CA9, which again was connected to Helios, and there we have it. And the hex alpha is going to start, and the sun driving through that. So remember that, old CA9 and Helios is for, or Apollyon, and all of that, if you want. This will help us to understand what's going on. And just so we understand is that in the next, we're going to look at some churches, and we're going to, because we're thinking about Alice Bailey of Lucifer's Trust, how she says that these traditional, or these type of churches, as well as the Masonic organism, are going to be initiation centers at some point. So, in the future, for this new universal religion. What I find interesting in this church here is that if you can just see right behind his head here, we have an almost like this all-seeing eye instead of a triangle here. Because, I mean, I'm just like, as we understand it, Constantine, he wanted to secretly link Jesus with Apollyon. So this would be the Helios or Apollyon all-seeing eye. And we'll see further evidences. Here's another church here. These will be initiating centers for the future. All-seeing eye right there, all shining out in the heavens. Here's another church here. You see all these little angels. It's all made to look Christian. But there we have it. All seeing eye shining. Evil star. Again, another cathedral. All seeing eye. Triangle. Yeah, here's a good one, actually. Remember how Apollyon was merged with Jesus by Constantine? So this, again, just makes sense because Constantine would... So obviously these people are taking forward Constantine's work secretly. Or maybe this look like Jesus, but this really all-seeing eye of Apollyon. And this being up here would have to be the great architect of Freemasonry, which would be Lucifer. And Lucifer, the Roman god, was a light-bringer, just like Jupiter, the Roman god, was light-bringer as well. And Jupiter was in the form of Zeus, and when you look at the Greek mythology, Zeus here was the father of Apollyon, or Apollo. You can see some very strong connections. Now we're going to be looking into the Catholic connections to the occult here. This is to do with one of the popes, called Pope Honorius. So let's look at the Catholic Pope Honorius. Again, you would never expect this to be going on, but he basically is one of these black magic rituals. And it says here, the grimoire of Pope Honorius is the first and most important of the French black magic grimoires which proliferated across Europe in the 17th to 19th centuries. Combining a grimoire of conjurations to demons, so we need to think about that, that has to do with communicating with demons, of the four directions and 7 days of the week, with a group of secrets full of simple charms, the grimoire of Pope Honorius was second only to the key of Solomon, and the influence it exerted on magicians, charmers, and cunning folk in both rural and urban France. This grimoire also played a role in social events which rocked France, being used in the affair of the poisons which scandalized the French royal court in 1679, and by the young priest who assassinated the Archbishop of Paris in 1857. So, it's quite, so when we have that in our heads, the idea that they're actually connecting themselves with demons, and I'm not going to say too much because the whole thing to do with black magic, the stuff that they delve into is extremely horrific. I had to actually take some of the slides out because it was really that bad, what they practice. But one of the things that they do need is that they need to be in graveyards, and they need to use, and they use the graveyards to communicate with demons, but they go inside the church because they've got a form of Christianized paganism, and they maybe read Psalms from the Bible, and their belief system is that they would use the altar, and then they would use the holy water to make a magic circle with, and that before they would eventually start communicating with demons, because they would manifest them, and the circle is meant to protect them in case they are getting killed or something. So that's basically how they use it. So this is what made me think to myself about what we're going to see next, is that they need to be in greater church here. It makes me wonder why they would have certain stalls here. You know, almost like a bat-like kind of wing or something, like a gargoyle kind of thing with a stall. You know, because, you know, they need dead bodies for some reason as well. So it's making me think to myself, is this one of the reasons why, I mean, why would you want to have things like that in a church? And it's like a Halloween thing, you know? It's, and then, of course, we look at it further. So, there's another church here. There's Jesus on the cross there. And we can actually, I can get the links now for these churches, but, I mean, this just seems a bit odd why they would have lots of skulls. I'm not going to say why these black magicians would want this, or I'm not going to say why. There's actually a lot of why. Again, here's another church here. Some little angels there. And they've got lots of skulls. There's a skeleton here. This seems a bit kind of odd. Yeah. And here's a church in Milan. Just riddled with lots of skulls. There's like decorating the place. Mm-hmm. And there's some nice paintings up there. It was sad to, because I mean, these will be initiating centers for the future when people want to delve into a coffee shop as well, which we'll look into. And of course, it makes me think about why they have gargoyles as well. Of course, gargoyles were meant to be used for to scare off evil spirits, but I'm starting to suspect something else is going on here, because when we look further into this, it'll start to make sense why they'd be likely to have all these things. Well, again, it's a St. Mary in France, Church of St. Mary, Baphomet type of statue. Got another chapel here, a devil-like creature. You can see there's little horns there. Looks like these. I mean, this is going on there. It will start to make sense when we get further into this. Mm-hmm. Again, these are just some more examples of these cathedrals. Freemasons, again, they're responsible for making a lot of these kind of Gothic cathedrals anyway, and they're Luciferians. And so it's almost like as if Lucifer has given them an excuse to talk to the demons. It's almost like that. See, that appears to be going on. We're going to look at the Luciferian connections to their own Catholicism here. That's what this is going to be to do with. Because what we're going to do is we're going to look at to see if Catholic priests and bishops and popes, this will be the Luciferians. To see if they have the same beliefs as the high level Freemasons do. Their beliefs that Lucifer is good. You can see that this is from a book called Lucifer the Throne by William Shawman. He was a Catholic priest. You can actually look into him and find out that, yeah, he definitely was a Catholic priest. He was actually learning black magic from a Catholic archbishop. You know, and he says here, he, which is Archbishop Catholic, that was also a black magician, told me, William, when I would be ready for the Luciferian priesthood. He explained that I would need to become a priest of Lucifer before I could become a Catholic bishop. So, you know, from his own experience, you know, it doesn't surprise me, you know, which we'll eventually get into later, it'll start to make sense even more. And even Bill Shumplin, he says here, I had to find out where I stood in relation to Jesus and Lucifer. Was Lucifer his father? And of course, Lucifer would be the father of Zeus, and Zeus would be the father of Apollo, and their way of thinking, their secret way of thinking. Or elder brother, which was through the Mormonism, as I had been taught at various times. So he was delving into a lot of occultic stuff, and sometimes you'll find that you'll hear certain testimonies of people being, him, for example, he had a lot of, when he was a high-level witch, he was actually, a lot of Catholic priests were coming to him to learn witchcraft, because I had a twisted form of a belief system that